What shall we say to these things? They're still cancer and so much disease. What shall we say to these things? So much hurting and broken esteem, so many questions, but still one answer. If God be for me, who can be against me? If God is with me, whom shall I fear? If no one knows me, still his heart adores me. I am safe, I am loved, I am healed. What shall we say to these things? So much violence, it's getting hard to believe. What shall we say to these things? So many people hurting with broken esteem, so many questions, but still one answer. If God be for me, who can be against me? If God is with me, whom shall I fear? If no one knows me, still his heart adores me. I am safe, I am loved, I am healed. If God be for me, who can be against me? If God is with me, whom shall I fear? If no one knows me, still his heart adores me. I am safe, I am loved, I am what can wash away my sins. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Singing, oh precious is that flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. If God be for me, who can be against me? If God is with me, whom shall I fear? If no one knows me, still his heart adores me. I am safe, I am loved, I am healed. If God before me, who can be against me? If God is with me, whom shall I fear?
My sisters and brothers, good evening to you all, and I welcome you to our Wednesday Bible study in this month of May. We're still enjoying the celebration of Easter, but we give thanks and praise to the Lord in this month of our Blessed Mother, the month of our Blessed Mother Mary. And so let us begin, as we begin all things, calling upon God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit to be with us and to open wide our hearts and our minds that we may study God's words and that it may be beneficial to us today. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Eternal and gracious God, we come before you today with our hearts open to receiving your word, that you may break open this world in our hearts and we may live by the examples that you alone give. We thank you for our journey so far. We thank you for the things that we have done right, and we ask for grace upon the things that we have not always done well. And so we ask that the word that flies around today may dwell in our hearts, that we may avoid the wickedness of life and be known as children after your own heart. We make all of these prayers, trusting that you will hear and answer us through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Lady, help of Christians, pray for us. In the name of the Father, Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Once again, I greet you all, and I thank you for your steadfastness and joining in our Bible study each and every day, each and every Wednesday. Last time, 2 weeks ago, we left off the fourth chapter for our study of the prophecy of Zechariah. And I fell in love with Zechariah when I started reading it because it had so much imagery. I'm a pictorial person, and I know some of you are. You know, Zechariah could have been a movie star. In our world today, he could have been in Hollywood and making a lot of money because of the visions that he had had. We have gone through so many last week. 2 weeks ago, we stopped at the fifth vision. And this was a vision that really, really is very, very terrifying if you look at it. But at the same time, it's a vision that enlightens us and tells us the connection we should always have with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Zechariah chapter 4 tells us that the angel of the Lord walked up to the prophet and said, "What do you see?" And the prophet says, "I see, you know, a lampstand made of solid gold," which means it's a lampstand that is made for worship of God, right? It's not a typical lampstand at home. This was a lampstand that is meant to be in the house of the Lord. It's gold, big. And on this lampstand, there are seven pipes. On each, seven pipes. And then on the seven pipes are the seven threads, you know, the nozzles in which the light comes out from. But that's not the end of the vision. The beauty of this vision is that there are two olive trees on each side of the lamp. Two olive trees. What in the world would an olive tree be doing next to a lamp? Remember, last time I said, an olive tree is where we get the oil from, the olive branch, the olive bunch in the seed itself is what is used to produce oil. Wait a minute, an olive tree, two of them, one on the left and one on the right side of the lamp? Yes, indeed. What was the olive tree doing? the olive tree was feeding the lamb. And that's such a biblical image, such a wonderful biblical image. The two olive trees were not doing anything else but feeding constant oil into the lamb. Typically, like we have the lamps that we have here, you know, for those who did not join us the last time, probably I do a little bit of an analogy. You know, the lamps that we have here, these lamps, you know, we have four, two on its side, but a lamp depends on oil. It needs oil in order to be able to be effective. So if Father Cornelius or the altar server or somebody forgets to put oil in the lamp, it goes dim. In other words, for this oil to be effective, it must have a constant, somebody has to constantly come around and fill it with oil. But the vision that the prophet sees is a totally different vision. It's a vision in which nobody, the lamp needed nobody to be able to feed it. It already has its own way of being fed by the two olive trees. That's such a beautiful self-lighting image, which tells us that God indeed, if we are plugged to our Lord Jesus Christ, He will feed us and we will always be burning for the Lord. We will never grow dim. Right? It's such a powerful image and I liked it a lot. And so the prophet was inquired what the meaning of this will be. The simple meaning, and that was a theme. God is saying to Zerubbabel, who was the political leader of the people at that time, because you know Joshua was the spiritual leader, the priest. Zerubbabel is the political leader, the governor, if you will, at that time. God is telling Zerubbabel, plain and simple, I am the one feeding you. Because they were building the house of the Lord. And you know, sometimes when we're doing something for God, we begin to think that it's my power, right? Whether you're a priest or you're a member of the parish or you're leadership, sometimes there is a tendency for us to begin to think in our head that, you know, I'm the one causing things to happen. No, no, no. God, by showing the prophet Zechariah that image, is reminding him and Zerubbabel and everyone, it's not by your power nor by your might, it's by my spirit. It is by my spirit. I am the one who caused the blessings to go. I'm the one who gives you the gifts to build the temple for me. I'm the one who gives you the strength and the resources and even the knowledge, the mental knowledge to construct the house of the Lord. So it is an appropriate image that we rounded off on before the end of Lent and the beginning of Holy Week, Triduum and Easter. God is saying to all of us, each and every one of us, you are not the cause. I am the one. I am feeding you directly. Even though you may not see it, your eyes may not see them, but I am the one feeding you and giving you the strength, the power, the tenacity to do what you are doing today. Okay? And so God reminds Zerubbabel also, yes, I am the one who feeds you, but at the same time, I will let you accomplish the work that you have started. You know, I said this 2 weeks ago, when Moses began the journey with the people, he didn't finish it because he went away from the Lord. The Lord, so God said, you're not going to complete it. But God reassured Zerubbabel that even though you have been thinking you are the source of your power, source of the wealth, no, you are not. Even though you have gone away from me, but I am still going to allow you to complete the work that you have done. And there will be great mountains, Yes, you're going to undergo obstacles, but what are the mountains? And no mountains high enough, isn't that what the song says? And no valley down deep enough. If we are united and plugged in to the Lord. And so I asked this question. I said, what are the mountains in your life that sometimes is holding you back from accomplishing the work of the Lord? Some of us, it could be our family members. There's a family member that is truly and doing all they can to be able to cause pain and distraction and distress. For you, what are the obstacles? In this month of Mary, this is the time we bring it to our Blessed Mother. You know, she is the undoer of knots. Whatever mountains that have become a knot to our life, you know, Our Lady becomes the undoer of knot. You know, I just got the books, and we will begin the devotion to Our Lady, undoer of knots. Because as you look around in our parish, in our families, there's so much. So many families tied up. You know, so many Christian communities are so bonded and bounded by pain and hatred and destruction and distress. So many family members, even my own family, so many are tied up to things that are not pleasing to the Lord. And so we need to call upon Our Lady, undoer of knots, to be able to pray for us and take our prayers to our Lord God, so that all of these series of knots that continue to hold us back will be untied and unknotted. Amen. And so what are the mountains? And I hope during Lent you are able to bring whatever mountains that hold you back. I hope during Lent you spend some time to bring them before the Lord and leave them with the Lord. If you didn't, the month of Mary is another opportunity for us to come before the Blessed Mother and ask. On Sunday we're going to celebrate Mother's Day. That's the time where, you know, we place our undue, and I hope the sodality and the daughters of Isabella are ready on Sunday, because they are going to be crowning the Blessed Mother as a sign of their own commitment to God and their commitment to following the example of our Blessed Mother as a good mother, a mother who is patient, kind, gentle, a mother who loves unconditionally, a mother who is there for her children even when everybody deserts them, a mother who is willing to bear pain that the children will cause and the children may cause. Okay. Another good image that I wanted us to learn is that oil, the significance of oil, and somebody asked me, Father Oak, if you don't mind, go through it again. So why is the olive tree pouring oil? What is the significance of oil? Last 2 weeks ago, I reminded us that oil signifies the presence of the Holy Spirit, right? That's why you will observe how beautiful we baptized 10 of our kids on Sunday. We placed the first oil on them, right? The oil of catechumen, preparing them. And once they have gone to the fount of baptism and they have returned from the fount of baptism and be baptized, we placed another oil on their head. A reminder that with the Lord they become kings and queens and priests and prophets. So oil is a sign of the presence of the Holy Spirit. When our kids will be confirmed, and those who were confirmed on Easter Vigil, you see oil, chrism was spread, smeared on them. Oil signifies the Holy Spirit. But in our own context as well, what are the physical importance of oil? Oil lubricates. I gave an analogy of a car. If you were driving a car and you don't change your oil frequently, you were just giving in to your car breaking down, your engine blowing up. Oil lubricates. And I reminded us that if we are lubricated by the Lord, then we will reduce the kind of conflict. You know, if you go to your engine, the way the engine works is that metal clash with metal, right? One metal is going over the other, and the car is able to move, right? If there is oil, the contact between several metals is smooth, and you can barely hear a sound. But if there's no oil, what happens? It's squeaking, and you hear the sound, and then it drives you crazy. Even in our own spiritual lives, when the Spirit is not in us, when there's no oil poured over us and in us, we begin to clash with one another and fight each other, and there's always noise amongst the Christian children of God, right? Another thing that oil does is that oil heals. The balm of Gilead, oil heals. You know, when your feet is cracked or you put oil on them, you know, it heals, right? Oil is a sign of healing. That's why the church requires the priest to go and anoint those who are sick. As I'll be doing maybe tomorrow, about two persons who will be going to anoint. Anoint those who are sick and just give them that strength to be healed by God. Oil lights, as we see. If there's no oil in our lamp, it burns out. It burns out. And no light comes out of it. Same thing in our spiritual life. If we are not energized and reinvigorated and revamped, and, you know, if we're not energized by the oil that goes in us, then we burn out. Right? We burn out, and there's no light coming on. Oil warms. When the lamps is heated up, you can warm yourself. It can bring heat. And I gave an analogy, and somebody reminded me about that analogy. I said, have you met somebody who is not warm? They make you miserable. So we want to have oil in us so that we can always be warm people, warm. We're warm towards each other, right? That's what oil does. I mentioned oil reinvigorates, oil adorns. In other words, oil, this is a beautiful aromatic smell that you perceive when oil begins to burn, especially not the adulterated oil, but the good oil. There's some fragrance that comes out of it, right? And some of you have those at home. It's like a perfume. And also, what we use oil for? We use oil to polish, to bring back something that is dried up, to bring it back to life. You know, when something is beginning to dry up, we bring it back to life via oil. So we can go on and on and on about the beauty of this image that we read from in chapter 4 of the book of the prophet Zechariah. And I invited you to please go back and read them now that you understand some of the images. Go back and read them and see how beautiful that God is promising that he was going to be the one who will fill us with the oil of gladness, right? It's not by our power. It's not by our might. But he himself is the one who causes everything to come to bear. And that if he oils us up, then he will make us accomplish whatever work we have started. Whatever work that God has put in our heart. If we are oiled up, if we are warmed up to each other, if we allow the oil of God as we are embarking on this over $100,000 project for our church to, you know, get our church a little bit of a good facelift. As we embark on it, we must be oiled up so that we can be able to accomplish it. If we're not oiled up, then there become frictions here and there, and doesn't help anybody, doesn't help in the ministry of God. Amen? So we must be branches. Another good image that tells us is that we must be people who are willing to be the source of God's blessings for others. The two olive trees became a source of oil. We too are invited to become a source of blessing, constant source of blessing to others. Let me say that again. We are invited to become constant, just like the olive tree is, not put one oil and I'm done. No. Be constant source of blessing to others. And you can't do it by your power, nor by your might, but by God's grace. Amen? Amen. So, And now that we have an idea of the fifth vision that Zechariah has, let's move into the sixth, and we're going to do the sixth and the seventh vision together, because they're short. They're not going to take a whole lot of time, okay? And so if you have the word of the Lord with you, if you open up the word, let's break it open. Let's read and together, right? And as we read, may his words bless us and fill us with our with his strength. Amen? Amen. Yes. Chapter 5. Again, I looked up and saw a flying scroll. Now, who's I? Who's I who looks up? The prophet, the same prophet, right? The one who have been seeing these visions. He said, I looked up, and what do I see? A flying scroll. A flying scroll. Can a scroll fly? Well, you know what a scroll is, right? A scroll is the word of God. In the Jewish tradition, before the Tabiblia, we have it today, before the Bible, like we have it today, became a book, the people read from scrolls. Scrolls are written, it's like a papaya. Some are made with different other a papyrus tree, and it's strong enough, and the ink can last enough and can hold. So once you have written the word of the Lord in it, and you read the word of the Lord from it, you can roll it up to read, and then you can roll it back. Right? Some days you see people who do certificates and diplomas in that way. They make it like a scroll. That's what it is. That's what the vision that he said. This time around, he says, I saw a scroll. Okay? Let's go to verse 2 and see what that means. And he said to me, that's the angel who had been helping the prophet Zechariah understand all these visions that he has been having. That angel said to me, what do you see? I answered, that Zechariah answered, I see a flying scroll. Its length is 20 cubits and its width is 10 cubits. Now, approximately 20 cubits will be 30 feet. 10 cubits will be about 15, right? So we're looking at a scroll that is about 30 feet wide, maybe 15 feet long. That's a big scroll. That's a big. But the beauty of this is that it's flying. Why is a scroll that is about 30 feet wide by 15 feet in length, why is it flying? It is flying because God wants us to see them. God wants his people to see them. The scroll is not rolled up and hidden. No, no, no. It's flying on the air. That vision tells us that this is God making sure that nobody says, I didn't see them. I didn't see the scroll. Remember, what is a scroll? The scroll contains the word of the Lord. And in this case, we will see that the scroll contains probably the 10 commandments that God gave to Moses that the people have been reading. We'll break that open in a short while. But for now, we understand that this 30 by 15 scroll is flying. Why is it flying? Why is it not seated on the anvil? No, it's flying. Because it is an urgency. God is making his word urgent. It is an urgency to it. And God wants everyone to be able to see him. That's why God wants us to want it to be flying. Okay? Now, another image about the length and the width is if you read 1 Kings chapter 6, verse 3, you will see that 30 by 15 is the dimensions of Solomon's porch in the temple. If you go back to 1 Kings chapter 6, verse 3, you will see the porch that Solomon built, when he built the temple, that temple that Solomon built, remember? David wanted to build a temple, and God said, no, I don't want you to build my temple. Your heir will do that for me. So Solomon went ahead and built that first magnificent temple for God. The porch of that temple that Solomon built is, in the word of the Lord, if you read it will tell you it is, its length is 20 cubit feet, and its width is 10. Okay? So it's not a coincidence. It's not something that is, you know, he just saw a scroll that has different dimensions. No. There is a link. The word of the Lord linked back to the temple of the Lord. Okay? So let's read on and see what this scroll entails. Then he said to me, this is the curse that goes out over the face of the whole land. For everyone who steals shall be cut off according to the writing on the one side, and everyone who swears falsely shall be cut off to the writing on the other side. See, that's why I said in this scroll, the content, the third and the eighth commandment, thou shalt not bear false witness. Thou shalt not use the name of the Lord your God in vain. Thou shalt not steal. Isn't that what the commandment said? Don't use the name of the Lord in vain. Don't steal. Right? So this scroll that is flowing and flying actually contains an urgent message to the people of God. Because remember, these are the people who were just returned from Babylonian exile. They have been freed. Cyrus had given them permission to go back home and rebuild. When we read previously, we heard that rather than rebuild the house of the Lord, they started rebuilding their own houses. In other words, these are people that have integrally lost sight of what God desires of them. Their years of slavery, their years of being in exile have had a toll on them. They have lost the message that God always puts on their laps, the message of being honest people, the message of constantly following what God demands and what God commands of them, right? So therefore, to get the attention of the people, God makes sure that this vision that Zechariah sees has a scroll that is open, because if the scroll that is, if it's rolled up and it's not open, then Zechariah cannot know the content. On the one side of the scroll, we're told that everyone who steals shall be cut off. That's the message. Everyone who steals shall be cut off. And then what is written on the other side? Anyone who swears falsely. So two accusations of the people of Israel, stealing and bearing, using the name of the Lord in vain, swearing by the name of the Lord and swearing falsely. The first one, stealing. Yes, they were stealing because they're desperate. Everybody has just come back to a natural land, a neutral land. So many people whose lands, those who own land who may not have returned, people were going stealing their lands and claiming the lands that were not theirs because perhaps the owner has not returned. So there were a lot of stealing, even amongst those who call themselves the leaders. They were stealing from the poor. And it became so rampant that God calls the attention to this malady, to this crime of stealing the land and stealing the property of others. And you know, that's what happened when we become desperate, we begin to put our hands and to take things that does not belong to us. Okay? The second crime that is written on the other side of the scroll, the people were swearing falsely. Now, in the Jewish tradition, to swear is not a crime. Right? To swear is not a crime. Therefore, because it's not typically a crime, what happens? What do the people do? They will now swear in the name of God. They will throw in God inside their swearing. Oh, you know, I swear by God that I did not do this. And so when people hear them attach God to their swear, they're swearing, people say, oh, yeah, he probably is telling the truth, because nobody can ever put God when they swear. But that became a problem. It became a way of life. Remember those two elders who caught Susanna, who wanted to have an affair with Susanna, and Susanna refused. What did they do? They swore, as God will have it, because they were elders, and people respected them. And because people respected them, they took advantage of the people. And sometimes we too do that. You know, we want to commit a crime. We include God. So that when people see us, they say, oh, it probably wasn't a crime because God was there. I remember of the story of the men who were caught stealing from a mall. These men, before they went to commit this crime, all took the rosary, the holy rosary, put it on their neck and kissed it before they went to commit a crime. Perhaps if they are caught, God is going to save them. Is that the reason? What about us? What are the swearing and the actions that we do, and we sneak in God to be able to cover up the mess that we are creating? That's why this scroll is flowing, the flying scroll. That's why this flow. And that's what God is bringing to the attention of these people who have just returned. Just because you are back to the land does not mean you should steal from the people. Just because you are back does not mean, you know, that you swear and use the name of the Lord your God in vain. Isn't that what the commandment became? That's why the commandment was given. Right? Everyone who swears falsely shall be cut off according to the writing on the other side. Verse 4. This is God now saying to those who refuse to change their ways. Verse 4 says, I have sent it out, says the Lord of hosts, and it shall enter the house of the thief and the house of anyone who swears falsely by my name, and it shall abide in that house and consume it, both timber and stones. So God is sending out this flying scroll, and he says, this flying scroll will go into the house of anyone who steals, who takes what does not belong to them. This flying scroll will go into the house of anyone who swears falsely in the name of the Lord. My brothers and sisters, let us just pause for a second. Let's just pause for a second and just let this sink in, that if we commit such crimes, that the word of the Lord will flow into our house. And when it flows into our house, it's not just coming to be flying around. It says it's coming to consume. It's coming to consume the house. All the timbers of the house will be wrecked down. Even the stones that the house is built with will be destroyed. And I think in truth, if we begin to understand that there are consequences for our actions, then it will begin to give us a different perspective, a different mindset on how we act towards God and towards one another. There are consequences to our actions. Now, you know, people say, oh, no, I don't steal, you know. But have you stolen somebody's joy? Oh, yeah, I don't go to the store and steal something, or I don't steal from somebody's purse. Okay, that's good. That's a good start. But have you stolen somebody's joy? Have you stolen a light from someone? In other words, you were supposed to, going back to our previous lecture, our previous studies, you were supposed to be the olive tree that fills other people and gives them the oil for them to grow. When we don't do that, when we don't carry out that action, isn't that stealing from the Lord? Have we borne false witness? What if we see something that is bad and we just ignored it and we don't want to be bothered? Isn't that bearing false witness? Isn't that testifying falsely? And so this first vision that the prophet Zechariah gives us is an invitation for us, a sincere invitation for us to be able to consider our lives and consider our ways, how much we have stolen from one another. We're not talking about stolen things that are physical, or, you know, we steal things that, you know, that are material. What about the spiritual things that we have stolen? The help that we're supposed to render that we're no longer rendering, okay? So that, in a nutshell, that's the first vision of a flying scroll. And so we pray that the flying scroll don't come into our house. Amen? Because the Bible says if it comes into the house of one who is a thief, or one who bears false witnesses to the Lord, it will consume and it will destroy. We pray that our hearts may be so good and clean that when the scroll comes to enlighten us. Because that's what the word of the Lord is a and amen. It enlightens, it fills us, and it gives us the knowledge that takes us up to our Lord. Now, Zechariah sees a second vision, still in the same chapter 5. So let's read from verse 5 all the way down, right? We'll break it up as we go. Then the angel of the Lord talked with me, the angel of the Lord who talked with me, came forward and said to me, look up and see what it is that is coming. Look up. Yeah, the angel of the Lord is always encouraging us to look up. Because if we are able to look up, then we see what God has in stock for us. But unfortunately, as Christians, so many times we have always been looking down. And then we went through the difference between looking up and looking down. Looking down means that, you know, you don't need the guy above, the one God who's above. You don't need the help. You know, everything you want is here on earth. That's what looking down is. Contentment, worldly contentment, is what looking down is. But looking up is in search of providence. You're searching for God's blessing. So a second time, the word of the Lord came to Zechariah and said, look up. It's a second vision. And so Zechariah did. Right? Verse 6, I said, what is it? He said, this is a basket coming forth. And he said, this is the iniquities of the land. So what does the second vision entail? A basket. A basket that is, the first one we see was the scroll that is flowing. Now there is a basket. A basket flowing What has this got to do with anything? No, the basket that is coming out, that basket that is coming out, he said, this is the iniquity of the land. In other words, the sins of the people are so much. The sins of the people have so much filled up that they are now placed in a basket. You know, when you go grocery shopping at the stores, I mean, if you're buying something small, you really typically don't need a basket. But when you're going to be buying something plentiful, more stuff, sometimes more stuff that you need, when we begin to buy so many stuff, then we need a basket. In the same spiritual way, the people's sins are so egregious that they are placed in a basket. And the prophet sees that basket that is coming out. And he said, this is the iniquity of the land. What are the iniquities of the land? These things that we just mentioned. False witnesses is part of them. Theft is part of them. Adultery is part of them. Idolatry is part of them. You know, there's so many sins. The people who came out to resettle in their land, you know, they've gone haywire. Remember, I always said, one of the most dangerous things is a Christian who relapses. That's one of the most absolutely dangerous things. It's a lot easier to deal with one who had never been a Christian and who just becomes a Christian, you know. But when someone has been living in the church and living their lives as a Christian, and they begin to relapse from their Christian faith, they become even more dangerous. In the same way, put it back into the analogy of what we are seeing in the story of the people of Israel. The people who have known God and have now been taken away from their knowledge of God and their worship of God and have now been taken into exile, and they have been adulterated, and they have received adulterated worship. Now that they are back, they are worse. Because they know a little bit of this and a little bit of that. They are worse. Same thing in our Christian faith. A Christian that is most dangerous is the one who relapses. Because they begin to justify their action. They begin to justify everything they do because of the knowledge that they have, the prior knowledge that they have. Okay? So, this basket that is coming forth contains the iniquities. Verse 7, it says, then a leaden cover was lifted up from the basket, and there was a woman sitting in the basket. Okay? This is a basket, and the prophet sees the basket coming out or forth. And the angel says, this basket represents the iniquities of the people. And the basket had a lid at the cover. And when the lid was opened, when the cover was taken out, what do we see? A woman. Now, before we begin to rationalize, because this is one of the scriptures that people use to belittle women. It's one of the scriptures that people use to begin to think of women. I just wanted to leap forward and saying, when they say woman in this concept, yes, it may be a woman, but also remember the Jewish word for wickedness is lerosha. Lerosha is the word for wickedness, and it's a feminine word. Remember, there's a masculine word and there's a feminine word. So this is not necessarily saying that the woman, that women are the source of wickedness. That's why I'm wearing the image of the Blessed Mother. Because if we say that, then we are invariably making a mistake of not realizing that this basket that contains this woman that represents wickedness, La Rocha, is also another, there's also another image of the Blessed Mother who is also carried into the world to be able to save humanity from their wickedness. I hope that makes sense. Because I know there are so many men who have read this passage and they say, oh, women are this and women are that. Let me not go into that. It's a false understanding of what the scripture teaches. So say, verse 8, and he said, this is wickedness, La Rocha. That's the meaning of the word in Hebrew. Wickedness means La Rocha, right? La Rocha. This is wickedness. So he thrust her back into the basket and pressed the leaden weight down on its mouth. So what he says is that, in essence, this wickedness was trying to get out of the basket. But what the angel of the Lord did was to force it back. Force it so much back so that the lead will be covered. It's kind of like when you open up you open up a solder that I've been shaking, and all of a sudden it wants to come out of its can, of the can. And then all you want to do is figure out a way to hold it back and to crush it back so that it doesn't come. That's the analogy here. What does that say to us? We are being shown an image of wickedness. The image that we see is the image of wickedness all around us. But God himself will not allow the wickedness to escape. But rather, God will squash, will cover up the wickedness and not let it. Your wickedness, our wickedness, my wickedness in this world is so vast that it's been found and placed in a basket. And as it tries to escape, God is going to try to hold it back. Okay? So, let's read on. Then I looked up and saw two women coming forward. The wind was in their wings. They had wings like the wings of the stork. And they lifted up the basket between earth and sky. So now the first image was the image of the woman in the basket that was trying to escape. And the image is that that's the wickedness of the earth. And now there's also two other women who are been invited, if you will, to carry the basket. To carry the basket. And he said the winds were on them. In other words, they were supported. What did the wind? Ruach. Ruach means the breath of the Lord. In other words, these two women carrying the basket were being supported by the wind of the Lord, right? There was wind on their wings. They had the support of God. And that they were carrying this basket, and they lifted it up between earth and the sky. Then I said, verse 10, to the angel who talked with me, where are they taking the basket? And he said to me, to the land of Shinar, to build a house for it. And when this is prepared, they will set the basket down there on its base. Okay. This is like movie 101. So these two angels carrying this basket represent the wickedness of humanity. As they carry this basket, lifted it up between earth and the sky, they're taking it up. And remember, they couldn't take it up if the wind was not with them. But we are told that they were carrying it to a place. Sinner, or Sheena. Where exactly is this place that they are carrying? Well, if you read Genesis chapter 10, verse 2, Genesis chapter 11, verse 2, Genesis 11, verse 2, you will see that there is a land called Sheena, in which, in that land, is where the story of the Tower of Babel took place. What is the correlation between this story and the Tower of Babel? Well, the great sin of the land, the great wickedness of the land in the book of Genesis was when the people came together, they united, not because they wanted to form an alliance, but they wanted to be united in order to fight God, in order to disprove the supremacy of God. And so they were of one mind and one voice and one language in the book of Genesis chapter 11. And so they said to themselves, let us build a house, that will be as high as where God lives. So they began to build. And then when God realized their wickedness, La Rocha, when God realized that they came together not because they wanted to be united for something good, but they wanted to be united against God, God caused confusion. And that confusion was the beginning of the breaking of the language in the Tower of Babel. So now, fast forward to the prophecy of Zechariah. This sin that the people who have come out from Babel, the same Babylon, this sin that they have learned when they went to Babylon, the sin of not worshiping God, the sin of worshiping idol, the sin of stealing, the sin of bearing false witness, the sin, all of the mess that they have brought with them from Babylon, back into their land after they have been set free. We were now told that that sin was now put in a basket. And that sin, those sins, are now being carried by two women, representing God's representatives and God's folks, right? That disproves people who think that all the angels are men. No, no, no. These are two servants of the Lord who are women, according to the word of the Lord, right? Yeah, I'm scoring a point today for women. So these two women now are going to carry and lift the sins of these people. God, remember, God doesn't want the sin to escape and continue to pollute the whole earth. When the sin wanted to come out, God forced it back. And now the two angels will now carry it. Where are they taking it back? They are taking it back to its origin, the land of Sheena, where God caused humanity to break up the language. See, sometimes the scriptures, look like they are standing in isolation. No. There's always a connection. Remember, one of the assignments I gave when we started Bible study last year, again, I was telling you, always find the connection between stories. So we now have found this connection that first sin that the people committed when they babbled in the land of Babel, right, because of their disobedience, that land is called the land of Sheena. And now, fast forward to hundreds of years afterwards, Zechariah says, all of the sins that the people have committed are now going to be taken back to the land of Sheena, where it all began. What is this passage? What is the message this passage is trying to pass for you and me? Number one, the word of God is the scroll. The scroll that you see flying is the word of God. And that word of God ought to be written in our hearts. Because if the word of the Lord is written in our hearts, then we'll be able to avoid the sin of theft and the sin of bearing false witness. So the word, that word is the word of God. So we, as Christians, we must do the best we can to ensure that this word is written in our hearts. Another message, that God is going to relentlessly judge individual sins. That's what the image of the basket of wickedness. You know, when we say wickedness here, we don't mean, oh, I ask you for bread. No. All sins are known as lerosha. Those sins are known as the sin of greed, the sin of backbiting, the sin of fighting each other. All those sins, God will relentlessly punish all the individual screen. Okay? And this is one of my favorite message, you know. See, God is good and merciful. No doubt. We can testify to that. But listen to this. But being good and merciful also entails being a good judge. Let me say that again. God is good and merciful. The Bible says he's slow to anger and rich in compassion. But the act of being good and merciful also entails the act of being a fair judge. God is going to judge every one of our sins and every one of us. It's going to be fair. If our sins outweigh our good works, God is going to make us accountable for them. So we have to be aware of our responsibilities to be accountable for our lives. At some point, the reason why you see the two women, the two angels, the two messengers of God will carry the sins back to the land of Shinar is because at some point in our time, God will like to cleanse our land. He wants to cleanse our land of all infirmity. Therefore, he will put all of our sins in a basket and push it off. And finally, I know as we walk these days, as we move on in our lives, it may appear that sin is winning, right? You know, sometimes we see people who are criminals, they excel. People who are drug addicts, they make a lot of money. Don't be deceived. They will pay for their sins. Don't ever be deceived. Those who are responsible for ill-gotten wealth will definitely pay for their sins. And so, my brothers and sisters, the flying scroll indicates for us that the word of the Lord flies. We hear them, we feel them, but hopefully the flying scroll, when they come to our heart, they come to cleanse us and to fill us and to empower us rather than to destroy everything, every fabric of our bones. Right? On the other hand, we'll hear that the word of the Lord is like a two-edged sword, right? It can be used to comfort. It can be used to destroy. That's what that passage means. So we have to be careful. The word of the Lord is flying. It's not hidden somewhere. It's up there. We all will see it. And we know what is in its content. We have to do the best that we can to be able to live by them. And so on this day, as we wrap up our studies today, the basket of wickedness and the flying scroll, or the flying scroll and the basket of wickedness. I just pray that we will go deep in our hearts and continue to ask God to be able to be our source and our strength, and that the word of the Lord may be alive and active in our lives. So, as we conclude, what are the messages that you bring to our studies today? What is it that you learn that you want to share between your brothers and sisters? I know you see me itching my eyes. These pollens are killing me. But, you know, we endure for the word of the Lord, right? Because of the Lord, we can do anything. So, what are the messages that you have today? Let me go back and see who has something to share with us today. I don't see any comments. Let me see. Michael Johnson Jr. says, armies, and it will enter into the house of the thief and into the house of the one who makes false oath. Yes, that's what that passage means. It will enter into our house. Can you imagine the Lord just sending a scroll to our house? That means we have to be prepared. We have to put our house and our hearts in order so that when it does come, it comes with its blessings and not its course. Who else? Let me see. I don't see any. So I want to thank you all. Next week we will just go through chapter 6 briefly, and then we will speak more about the hypocrisy of fasting and what fasting entails and what are the things that we require in chapter 7 on the book of Zechariah. I know Zechariah is a long book, but we'll do our best to finish it up in a couple of weeks. I know you all are ready to move to Malachi. But before we get to Malachi, we still have a couple of very good imageries and very good thoughts that the prophet Zechariah offers us. And I pray, just read ahead, and if you have any questions, send it to me or put it in the comments. And our coordinators will indeed bring it to my awareness. I thank you all. I don't see any question again or any concerns. So, if we bow our heads and pray to God and ask God for his blessings. Most merciful God, we come before you today to thank you, for you have reminded us that the scroll that flies may either bring us joy or may bring our destruction. And so, Lord, we ask that you may remove from us all the antics of the devil so that we may live right by you and that we may avoid the basket of wickedness that is flowing. And that if the fountain of life that flows in our hearts, the grace of God and the peace of Christ himself may abide with us both now and forever. We thank you, Lord, and we ask that through the intercession of the Blessed Mary, Ever Virgin, and that you, our God, may continue to fill us with your blessings in this month of May, and that you may bless all mothers and all those who play the role of mothers, that as we take this opportunity to thank them and to bless them, that you indeed may watch over them and reward those who have gone before us marked with a sign of faith. And like the Blessed Mother, may all mothers continue to be a sign of joy and peace to humanity. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. And may Almighty God bless and keep you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you all again. Just want to remind us that tomorrow we have to go to the priest council meeting in the archdiocese. So tomorrow Mass is at 9 a.m. Please remind those who join us, whether live stream or in person, Mass tomorrow will begin at 9 a.m. and not 10 as usual. So thank you all. And as you continue to struggle with life, we pray for you. And to all mothers, happy Mother's Day. And may you be blessed. God bless you.
Surrender all to Him, I freely give. I will ever love and trust Him in His presence daily. Blessed Savior, I surrender all to Jesus. I surrender at His feet I bow. Worldly pleasures all forsaken, take me, Jesus, take me now. Blessed Savior, I surrender all to Jesus. I surrender, make me Savior, holy Thine. Fill me with Thy Holy Spirit. Truly know that Thou art mine. I surrender all to Thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all to Jesus. I surrender, Lord, I give my